to introduce Justin Brooks. Justin's the director and co-founder of the California Innocence Project. He's a tenured professor of law at California Western School of Law. Over the course of his career, he has served as counsel on many high-profile cases, and he has exonerated more than 30 innocent people, including people from death row. So Justin is going to tell us about how the forces of bias and false narrative and misinformation in California have cost people their freedom and their lives. And it's, to me, a great close to today's event, because the work of journalists is to seek the truth, counter to false narratives, counter to disinformation, and it's the work of audiences like you all to always seek the truth with an open mind. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Justin, and he's got a very powerful story to tell. Justin Brooks, everybody.
So a couple of weeks ago, I spoke to the California Judges Association, and I opened by saying, wow, it was so nice to talk to all of you in one room. I usually talk to you one at a time, and that's kind of how I feel about all of you as well. I recognize a lot of people here in this room I talk to one at a time, and so this is great to get all these people together. And I feel a real affinity, a real closeness with journalists that I probably didn't, honestly, when I started practicing criminal law 30 years ago. But the wrongful conviction movement has really been hand in hand with journalists. It's been lawyers and journalists fighting this battle. One of the original innocence organizations was in a journalism school in Chicago. And Chicago is also where my journey began. 27 years ago, I received I actually read in the newspaper a story about a woman sitting on death row in Illinois. And the story said that she had been sentenced to death on a plea bargain. So let that sink in for a second. So she had been sentenced to death on a plea bargain. It made no sense to me either. So I went out and met her on death row. She was scheduled to be executed. She was a kid, 21 years old. And she said an amazing thing. She said, "I'm innocent." I said, "You bled out, you got the death penalty, and you're innocent." And she said, "Yeah." So I went back to the law school where I was teaching and told exactly that to my first year criminal law students. There's a woman sitting on death row, she says she's innocent, who wants to help me out? And four brave, stupid souls raised their hands. And that night, we gathered around my kitchen table. We started going through the paperwork, and for me, the Innocence Project was born at that time. This was just shortly after the O.J. Simpson trial. Barry Scheck was one of O.J.'s lawyers. He went back to New York. He started the Innocence Project there. At that point, there were four or five of us that had started these fledgling projects. And after I was able to get her death sentence reversed, and unfortunately, I wasn't able to get her out of prison, I was inspired to move to California and start the California Innocence Project. I think there were two reasons I was inspired. Number one was I literally remember vividly walking back to my car after I got a new jury to resentence her to the best I could do, which was life in prison. I'm walking back to my car, 24th in California in Chicago on a freezing cold day, and I thought, this is the kind of work I want to do for the rest of my life. But it also might have been the influence that it was a freezing cold day that I decided I want to do it in California. So I told my wife, bad news, good news. Bad news, I'm quitting my tenured faculty position here in Michigan. Good news is we're moving to California, and I'm going to start this thing up, and we're going to make something out of it. And so 2 years ago, I was asked by a publisher to write about my experience since then doing this work. My wife is from a little village in northern England where we're fortunate enough to have a little 240-year-old stone cottage. So I went and hid out there for a couple of months, and the result was this book that's due to come out this month. Kind of going through, you know, what are all the causes of wrongful conviction? Sort of, what have we learned? Because when I started this work, there really wasn't a critical mass of cases to study and figure out what are the causes of wrongful conviction. Yeah. And as Peter Neufeld likes to say, who's the lawyer at the Innocence Project in New York, he says, well, there's a plane crash. You know, you want to study the plane crash. So there's not future plane crashes. And every one of these wrongful convictions is a plane crash. It's a plane crash for the victims. It's a plane crash for the defendants who go wrongfully to prison. It's a plane crash for all of us who are part of the criminal justice system, which represents us. But now, 3 decades later, we do have that critical mass of information that we didn't have before. And we now have more than 3,000 documented cases of wrongful conviction in the United States. And if you look at the Registry of Exonerations, which is a very serious scholarly piece of work, and the website, you can see all the causes running through all the cases. And every time I have an exoneration, these guys will call me, and I have to send them all the pleadings and all the paperwork. I have to kind of argue my case again to prove it to them that this is an innocence case. And when they declare an innocence case, they make it part of their database. So this is no longer talking about Reuben Hurricane Carter and a few cases that were floating around 30, 40 years ago. It's now a large number of cases. And so what have we learned? Well, the first thing we've learned is there's a lot of bad lawyering going on. You know, and I work all throughout Latin America. I've started 32 innocence projects in Latin America that I coordinate from my office here in San Diego, all the way from Chile to the Mexican border. And I see some fairly shocking stuff going on in Latin America in terms of lawyering. Mexico just started doing trials 8 years ago, hasn't had trials for 400 years, and just started doing them, but they're still not training in the law schools on how to do trials. But what I see here in our country, even though we have this incredibly specific and lengthy training for lawyers, in most countries it's an undergraduate degree. Here you gotta go to university and then go to 3 more years of school and then you gotta pass a bar exam. It's not that lawyers aren't smart. It's not that lawyers aren't competent. It's that lawyers aren't going out and doing investigations. It's that they're not finding out the truth. So we don't see these outrageous mistakes in trial very often. We see some of them. But what we see every time is failure to investigate, failure to find out the truth in these cases. And Maryland's was one of those cases. So Maryland, my death case I was talking about in Chicago, in that she got assigned a really great public defender, a woman who'd done hundreds of homicide cases, and yet she made the mistake that I've seen over and over again in that thinking, oh, I don't want a public defender, I want a private lawyer, I want a real lawyer. Mm-hmm. So her friends get together $10,000, they hire a guy in the neighborhood who's never handled anything remotely like this, gives him $10,000, and he goes in and pleads her straight up to double homicide without even meeting with the prosecutor, and then she gets sentenced to death in a 15-minute sentencing hearing. And that's in the United States of America that happened. And on top of it took me a year to find this guy. Usually lawyers are easy to find. Where do I find him? I find him studying to be a priest at University of Detroit. He's now an actual priest. And you know, and if the following fact, if this case was ever turned into a movie, I have to change the following fact because it's so corny. His name is literally Father Lynch. Father Lynch was the lawyer that Lynch, my client, got out of the death penalty. But he's doing his penance, I guess, every Sunday. So you know, I've seen a lot of bad counseling cases. I also look closely at this intersection of cases we have from the desert in California and cases that we have from the inner city in Los Angeles particularly. And in both places, you cannot safely assume you won't be wrongfully convicted. Because before I moved to California, I didn't realize that things got weirder the further you got from the water. But I figured out that after doing a couple of cases out in San Bernardino and Riverside and some other places. And in the desert counties, what we find is really, really incompetent work being done. and a lot of it in the policing side of it. Our client, Bill Richards, came home one night, found his wife beaten to death, and the police didn't come for a long time. They had to keep calling them back. When they finally came, they didn't even secure the body. They didn't do any time of death analysis. They left her body on the front lawn overnight. While police were on the scene, dogs started burying the body, which kind of wrecked all the forensics that we're trying to do later on. And we see case after case of that kind of sloppy work happening in rural areas that are under police. And on the flip side of it, we see in the inner city cases that we have over-policing going on, where large groups of people are captured up in these sting operations and these mass arrests that are very difficult ever to prove innocence. When you have the seven kids picked up on a street corner and the drugs are not even carrying them, they have them in a separate location, but under our possession laws, you can be charged with possession with drugs you're not carrying. And you know, maybe that kid stopped to talk to a friend of his who's on the football team, but it doesn't matter. There's a lot of people getting caught up in the net when there's over-policing. So there's sort of under-policing and over-policing that goes on. And that's Bill Richards, who we finally freed after 23 years in prison. And then, along with that, this interesting phenomenon of when you come home, and there's a whole chapter of this in my book because I've seen so many of these cases. Basically, the person who finds the dead person is going to be looked at as a suspect if they can't find somebody else who's obvious for it. And the reason is because you can put this person on the scene, and you can probably come up with a motive, because it'll always be that person who wants to insert themselves in the drama, you know, the friend of the wife who's saying, oh, no, she told me there were problems in their marriage. And, you know, you always have that kind of lineup of people. And then all the forensics put the person there at their own home, shockingly. And we've seen multiple of these cases. We've exonerated, just in my office here in San Diego, three different people who were basically convicted because they walked in and found the body. Now, I'm not encouraging you to tiptoe out when you find a body, but it does put you in a position to potentially be convicted of that. Kim Long is one of those cases out of Riverside. She came home, found her boyfriend beaten to death. She had the unfortunate circumstance that earlier in the day she was seen having an argument with him. So she had an argument with her boyfriend, and then, you know, there she is on the scene. We can put her there. And even though she called 911 and tried to get help for him, she ultimately gets convicted. And her case was an example of the kind of lawyering that where we see mistakes being made. Because, sadly, the lawyer she had at trial was simultaneously doing a couple of other very serious homicide cases. And he missed one little detail in the file that could have exonerated her at trial. And it was that everyone agreed, all the experts, that whoever killed Ozzy, her boyfriend, had blood on him. Because there was 360-degree blood splatter. And Kim had no blood on her. But what did the prosecution argue? That she must have changed her clothes. And what he missed was there was an actual arrest photo of her wearing this very specific t-shirt that two witnesses described in reports as exactly what she was wearing earlier in the day at the bar. And that fact alone was enough to exonerate her. And the guy who did that, by the way, is a reporter, a guy named Randy Page, who's a CBS reporter in LA, got obsessed with this case. And he worked alongside me, and he ended up doing a 5-part podcast on it. And Randy went and tracked down all the jurors and asked each one of them, would you have convicted Ken Long if you'd heard this piece of evidence? And they all said absolutely not, and were very angry that they had been put in the position of putting an innocent woman in prison because all the evidence wasn't presented to them. And it's just a classic case. Chapter 4, I look at a topic that I believe has become the leading cause of wrongful conviction around the world. And it's very basic and very complicated at the same time. There's basic reasons that people get convicted because they look like other people, and then there's scientific reasons of why it happens. And it starts with this. This is actually the lineup from the Valero case. So this is the lineup that the identification came about that led to my client being sentenced to death. And if you look at this lineup, who do you think is not concerned that they might be facing double homicide charges and end up getting the death penalty? Who would you say? Who do you think?
Me?
Yeah.
The woman second from the left.
The California Innocence Project, along the dark side. Yes. Look at this woman. She's smiling. She's actually laughing when you see the video of this. Why? Because she's a secretary of the police department and they need to do a lineup of Puerto Rican women. So they go over to her desk and say, hey, you mind standing in a lineup? We gotta do a lineup of young Puerto Rican women. And she's like, oh, that's fun. I'll stand in a lineup. I'm standing in a lineup. I'm standing, this is great. I'm standing in a lineup. I'm standing. That's not the person who gets picked. Okay? Most of our communication we do is nonverbal. Right? Like, I could literally right now take a picture of all of you and give you a grade of 1 to 100 of how interested you are in what I'm saying based on your facial expressions. We're constantly communicating with each other, giving and taking. The other person who's having a good time, this woman, she's dropping the lunch off for her sister in the probation department. She's happy to stand in a lineup. I don't know where they got Shorty here from, but she's also having a good time. None of them have any concern about what's going on here. You know who's concerned? My client, Marilyn Olero. She's got the 500-pound hands like a first-year law student on call, and she's scared to death, and she's projecting fear, 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 fear. And you know who kind of doesn't care about any of this? This is the actual killer, Jackie Montanez. She's 15 years old. She just killed two dudes, one bullet to the back of the head to each one of them, and she's just being Jackie up there like, I don't care. I don't care. I don't care. And it starts with that. It starts with just that it's a human process where people are looking at people and they're trying to pull information out of their memories, and we're just not that good at it. We're not good at it, right? And I don't think we need experts to explain this. When I train lawyers about it, I say, you know, you don't necessarily need an expert to explain to a group of human beings that their memories aren't very good. And I always use the example of, you know, I say to a group of jurors, I'll say, you know, ladies and gentlemen, have you ever been in a restaurant and you order onion soup and you're looking right at the waiter and it's a bright light and you're not scared and no one's got a gun in your face and you say, I like the onion soup. And then they walk away and you're thinking, you know what, that tomato soup at the next table looks pretty good. I think I'll have the tomato soup. And then you look up and think, which one was my waiter again? How many of you experienced that? All of us. Exactly. And that's the best possible identification scenario you could be in. You're making the ID a minute later, not an hour later, not a day later, not a week later. Some of my cases, months later. There's no fear. There's no gun in your face. You're maybe not drunk, maybe not high, I don't know. But with a lot of these situations, we see people who are drunk and high and scared and guns are in their faces and they're making these IDs months later. And they're also making them in shaky ways, but the problem is the jury doesn't see that. The jury doesn't see that when the witness picked her and said, you know, kind of looks like number one. And then the police officer says, oh, good job. Now they're sure it's number one. And now when he gets dropped, they're like, I'm 100% sure it's her. That's what the jury sees. So they don't see the whole process leading up to that. There are so many problems with IDs that I have almost no confidence in any of them. And the worst ones I see are cross-racial IDs. They are horrendous. Absolutely horrendous how easy it is to lead someone into making a bad ID. And it's nothing to do with racism. And we need to be able to talk about that with jurors. It's to do with how our facial recognition software works. And how in the first 4 years of our life, we develop the ability to recognize faces. So I have a grandson right now. I know that's hard to believe with my youthful parents, but I did. And he's 15 months old. And I've just watched him go through this of figuring out, you know, who mom is, dad is, who his grandparents are. And if your mom's white, your dad's white, your brother's white, your sister's white, every child that you're exposed to in the first 4 years of your life, or most of them are white, you will not be good at identifying people of color the rest of your life. You can't actually catch that up. And I've seen this time and time again. I've walked six people out of prison identified by horrible cross-racial identifications that were completely wrong. And one example of a bad ID case is a local San Diego case. This guy, Uriah Courtney. It's a horrible case where a 16-year-old girl in La Mesa is pulled off the side of the road by a guy in a truck, sexually assaulted, pulls her behind a bush and sexually assaults her. And she escapes, and she ends up in the police station making a drawing of her attacker and the truck. And this is the actual drawing that she made. Okay, now take a look at that drawing for a second. and study the details. Then the police use this for their photo array to make identification. Now, what's the problem with this photo array based on this drawing? So there's only one feature in this drawing, right? I mean, I assume the dude had ears. He probably had eyebrows. The only thing she put in was it's a guy with a goatee. And then when they come around to do the photo array, what do? Number one, no facial hair. Number two, no facial hair. Number three, he's got a little Scooby-Doo thing going on. Number four, my client, oh, goatee. Number five, nothing. Number six, got the Fu Manchu kind of thing. My client's the only one who actually matches, the only describing factor, and it's the least significant factor you can have, right? Facial hair. Facial hair that can change every day. You know, it's in the top five of best things about men, experimenting with your facial hair, but it's fleeting. It's right up there with not having babies, getting paid 22 cents more on the dollar, things like that. But here, that's the only identifying feature. So of course she identifies him, and he gets convicted. And now, literally at his sentencing, he says, he looks over at this girl, 16-year-old kid, and says, someday they're going to figure out that they got this wrong, and that I didn't do this, and I don't want you to feel bad, because I know you did the best here that you could. I'm just imagining. He's a way better person than me. We petition the court to DNA test their clothing. We find male pattern DNA all over it that doesn't match our client. But, you know, that's not great, right? Because it's kind of horrible to think about. You all right now have DNA from other people on your clothes just from sitting on these chairs. So we then enter it into the data bank. And on the day we enter into the data bank, we had 10,500,000 offender profiles in it, and we get a direct hit with this dude, who lives a few blocks away, who committed other sexual assaults, and look at his picture next to my client's. She didn't do a terrible job. I mean, white dudes, late 20s, similar forehead, similar hairlines, dark eyebrows. Interestingly enough, in his prior arrest photo, no goatee, so that's not part of it, but they look very similar, but they're not. And this is how basic it is. This is how simple it is for someone to get convicted of something they had nothing to do with. We finally got a law passed last year to change the identification procedures throughout California. Los Angeles had resisted us even after paying over $100 million in lawsuits due to bad ID cases. And now they no longer can use six-pack photo arrays. You no longer can have a police officer present who knows who the suspect is as part of the procedure. It's got to be double-blind procedures. You've got to inform the witnesses that the person may not be there. All this sort of basic stuff to do it better, but we'll never be able to perfect it because of the problems with human memory. And that's where I am today. He got out with his parents. Jason Kindle was another one of our bad ID cases. Jason was actually identified based on his voice. This was the first exoneration we had in California. And Jason got convicted of robbing an Office Depot where he worked. And the responding officer, and this is what often happens, made an assumption that then took the whole investigation off the rails. And his assumption was, must have been an inside job because this guy knew who the manager was. Now next time you're at the Office Depot, see if you can figure it out. That's the guy in the blue vest. What's the passing? So then what does he do? He runs background checks on everyone who works there. My guy comes up with a prior marijuana charge. So now the officer's focused on my guy. The robber was wearing a mask, so nobody got to see his face. So the police officer goes around the store and says, did it sound like Jason? And one woman says, yeah, it did sound like Jason. And he got convicted based on that. Fortunately, we had found a video of the robber walking in the store. We were able to figure out from the height of the door how tall the robber was. If it had been 1 or 2 inches different, I don't think we would have won, but it was 6 inches difference. And we brought it in front of Judge Ito, actually not long after the O.J. Simpson trial, and Judge Ito released him. Rafael Madrigal had the best alibi I've ever seen. He was working in a factory 30 miles from the crime scene at the time the shooting happened, had zero connection to it, no physical evidence, no motive, nothing except for one white woman, and he's Latino, who identified Rafael from a picture taken when he was a teenager and he was nearly 30 when the crime happened.
Oh.
Nothing else, and he got convicted. Why? Because his lawyer didn't go to the factory to shore up his alibi. And when we went there, we not only found time cards punching him in and out, witnesses that said he was there, we had the owner of the factory who said, if Raphael wasn't at work at that exact moment the shooting happened, our entire assembly line would have shut down because he was the only one who knew how to use this piece of laminating equipment in the middle of the assembly line. And that's the day he's released with his mom. Adam Riojas is a San Diegan. He's actually now a minister here in North County. He spent 13 years in prison for a murder he didn't commit, also based on bad identification. Guy Miles was in Las Vegas at the time a bank robbery happened in Orange County. And there were 10 witnesses that put him there. And he still got convicted based on cross-racial identifications done with a very highly suggestive procedure. But because it was Orange County, it still took a very long time to get a guy out. And I actually worked on this case for 15 years before getting him out. And this is the night of his release. And you can see the look on my face is the look of a lawyer who spent 15 years working on a case. We didn't tell his parents we were bringing him home that night. And this is us bringing Guy home.
I'm home, baby girl, I'm home.
That's his daughter.
Justin is right here. He's right here. He's not lying. We're going to come home and this nightmare is over.
Supporting him the whole time. They don't actually know he's coming home tonight, but we're gonna bring him home right now to him. And, you know, it's just a huge relief for the California Innocence Project to be done with this case and bring him home. We've been waiting a long time.
Luis got convicted of three of them. Even though that they continued, one happened when he was on trial and in jail, others happened while he was in prison, and we were able to go back and match up the DNA from the various crime scenes to show that there's no way he committed any of these because he was incarcerated when they happened. And by the way, the district attorney didn't think it was useful to turn over the information to the trial attorney that this exact MO rape had occurred the night before while the trial's going on, and Luis is sitting in jail, so all kinds of what we call Brady violations. Reggie Cole, 17 years in prison, bad identification. Reggie was an insane case taken on by an amazing San Diego lawyer who's now a judge, Chris Floyd. And Chris sucked me into that, working on it with him. 17 years in prison. Tim Atkins, 23 years in prison, bad identification. Tim was literally just the first, young black man on the street corner they could pick up and charge with this crime. And you see what this child has done to me with my hair, by the way. Look at that hair. Thick, brown, vibrant. Ready to take on the world. Quinn Morris, 27 years in prison, bad ID. Lowell Adams, 28 years in prison, bad ID. Glenn Boyd, 28 years in prison, bad ID. And by the way, these are just all cases from my office. And we now have 60 innocence organizations in the United States. We have another 100 around the world. Every single office has a pile of these because they're so prevalent. In chapter 5, I get into the, you get confused when you're tired and hungry and people are yelling at you. We now know innocent people confess to crimes they didn't commit. We know that for a fact. However, every time I talk to an audience about it and say, how many of you think you'd never, let me ask now, how many of you think you would never confess to a crime you didn't commit? Still people, you're excluded. Please send me your names. That's the problem. There's always going to be jurors that believe that. Interesting, too, that with a lot of women, it's almost always all men that answer that question in the affirmative. Interesting. Well, it happens, ladies and gentlemen. We now know that 17% of DNA exonerations have involved false confessions. We now definitively know that innocent people confess. There's a whole panoply of reasons, but what I've seen as of late, it's not getting beat up, it's not being broken down and crying, it's just getting fed up. And it's sort of like, okay, after 14 hours, all right, give me the, I did it. Great, you got me. And people thinking, they're not going to convict me on this because I didn't do it. But now maybe they get a bad identification, maybe they drum up a snitch from the jail, and now you're getting convicted based on a bad confession. The bottom line is the debate is over. We now know definitively that innocent people do confess because we've had so many definitive DNA exonerations in confession cases. Another reason is the Reed technique, which has become a global standard for police interrogations. And this guy Reed got his training out to the whole world. And a lot of people think the Reed technique is about getting the truth, and it's not. The Reed technique is focused on getting someone to agree with you. You come up with your narrative for the truth, and then you get someone to agree with it. This is just what lawyers, by the way, are trained to do, too. That's what a cross-examination is. Then you went to the house, right? And then you went in there, right? And then you had a gun, right? And then you shot the person, right? I mean, it's suggestive questioning. But lawyers do it in a courtroom with a judge in only a limited amount of time. Police do it over hours and hours, overnight, multiple detectives, and eventually you get them to go along with your story. And it's only people who are very strong-willed that go against that. And then, by the way, there's a lot of people I've seen a bunch of cases where people aren't sure whether they did the crime or not because they were blackout drunk. And when you're blackout drunk, you can be convinced of anything. Or like Marty Tankloff, who woke up one morning, a 17-year-old kid in New York City. His parents were stabbed to death overnight in their beds. And the police bring him in, Marty, a high school kid, and fake a phone call from his dad saying, Marty killed me, Marty stabbed me and my wife. And the police saying, your dad's on the phone, he says you did it. And this kid who's just gone through both his parents being stabbed to death in his home and is so traumatized by it, it's kind of like, well, if my dad said I did it, then I must have done it. And he goes to prison for 20 years. Marty's now a criminal defense attorney in Manhattan who's 20 years in prison. In chapter 6, I talk about the saddest cases that we have in our office, and those are the cases of baby deaths. They're the most expensive, they're the most difficult, they're the most tragic. Try to imagine, this is a horrible thing to imagine on a rainy, late Saturday afternoon in San Diego when I'm the last speaker. But those of you who have children, the idea that your child dies, and then people start suspecting you of killing your child, and then your family, friends, people in your community believing you killed your child, and then going to trial for that, spending every penny you have in the bank to defend yourself, and then going to prison as a baby killer. It is as bad as it gets. You're on the absolute lowest ebb. And by the way, my clients who go to prison in baby death cases usually have zero protection in prison. Because first of all, that's the lowest of the low in prison. And second of all, most of the people this impacts aren't people who are affiliated with gangs, have groups that can protect them. Like, they're out there in the open in prison. And so guys like Ken Marsh, we got to pitch one, we'll get to Ken in a second, who's a San Diegan, when he went to prison, you know, he had to be locked in protective custody for almost the whole time he was in there. And when we walked out 20 years later, Ken couldn't cross the street without me holding his hand. Aww. He had spatial things, he had constant panic attacks, he had spatial just kind of dysmorphia because he was locked in a small cell for 20 years. And the reason this is happening is because doctors are still being trained in medical school that when they see this triad of symptoms, so dural hematomas, retinal hemorrhaging, and cerebral edemas, which are basically just blood on the brain, bleeding in the back of the eyes, and swelling of the brain, that's an abuse case. Now, many times it is an abuse case. I'm not denying that. That's why these cases are hard to sort through. Which are the ones where there was abuse, which is the ones where there wasn't abuse. But we now know, after all these cases, that all these things also cause the triad of symptoms. Shortfalls, encephalitis, meningitis, birth trauma. There are people in this room statistically that suffered the triad of symptoms when you were born. It's just what happened was you went home, the swelling went away, and you were fine. But what would have happened if you went home and rolled off the changing table, hit the floor, showed up in the emergency room with your parents? They're going to be looking at them as a suspect, they're going to do an x-ray, they're going to find these injuries, and then your parents are going to go to prison for murder. That's what ends up happening. So you can have the symptoms and be totally fine, it's just you get later injuries because we don't do CAT scans on babies, we don't do x-rays on babies. If they look fine, and then, you know, they have some internal swelling going on, they're just going home. Especially the insurance companies run our hospitals, but that's the part of the day. And there's Ken on the day he got out of prison. 20 years in prison, and fortunately, Bonnie Dumanis, our former district attorney, agreed with me that he should be released and that when we have new scientists, new experts look at the evidence, that he's factually innocent. Suzanne Johnson's another one, San Diego case, 21 years in prison. That's the day she got out. We just got her out a couple years ago. Alan Mendez, another San Diego, 24 years in prison. Matt and Grace Hong was the most surreal case I've ever worked on in my career. It's actually a couple I represented in the Middle East. I flew over there, did the trial in Qatar, in Arabic, the translator. It's a lot of fun. And they were a couple that just woke up one morning and their daughter that they adopted from Africa was dead. And we still don't know why she died because they faked an autopsy. And it was just one racist police officer who saw Asian parents and black children and said, oh, they must be slave traders. And then took them into custody and then fabricated the case from there. I actually cannot return to Qatar. They told me I'll be put in prison myself for my comments to the New York Times about this case. So I won't be going to the World Cup. And then there's all the bad science cases. So many, there's an endless stream of them, and I could spend hours and hours talking about them, but I can't today. But we've got all kinds of new science with ballistics. The bite mark cases are such junk cases. These are bored dentists who watch too much CSI, okay? They're horrible cases. Bite mark is not a science. All these guys have been freed from prison after bad bite mark cases. We also know there's problems with fingerprinting because in the Madrid bomber case that proved all the problems with fingerprinting, that they're only as good as the experts doing the cases, the equipment they're using, and even some of the top experts, by the way, make mistakes because they still have to make a judgment call among fingerprints. And a great study was done where they took five fingerprint experts, showed them two fingerprints from one of their own cases where they declared them a match, and told them they were the fingerprints from the Brandon Mayfield case, because every fingerprint expert in the world knew that that wasn't a match. So they all came, four out of five came back and said it's not a match. And they said, that's interesting, that's one of your own cases where you testified it was a match. So there's human error in those cases as well. It's not as bad as bite marks, obviously, but there's problems. Hair analysis is junk science. There's arson, there's so many bad arson cases. Again, you have a lot of so-called experts who are firemen who have a lot of time on their hands and watch too much CSI. But they might know how to put them out of fire, but that doesn't mean they're good at analyzing fire. So. And there's Joanne Parks, who we got out of prison. She spent 29 years in prison after she was falsely convicted of a fire that killed her children in a house. And it was just bad science. Chapter 8, I talk about all the child molestation cases that we've worked on. And you want to talk about cases that are hard to separate the innocent from the guilty? These are the hardest ones of them all. Because there's not the tells that you see in other cases. I mean, for example, we always get an avalanche of letters. This guy would never do this. He's a priest. You know, this guy would never do this. He's a school teacher. That's worth zero in terms of evidence of innocence. And a lot of times, the evidence of innocence we have is the child comes forward years later and says, no, dad didn't molest me. Mom didn't molest me. Well, the judge is going to look at that as a million reasons not to believe it. But there are a lot of these cases. California has the most famous case in history, which is the McMartin preschool case, which was the most expensive trial in the history of the United States, by the way, when that was tried, because they had to actually excavate the preschool to find the underground caverns where the children were allegedly being tortured, and they found that it was all fake. It was all made up testimony by the children. I had a very famous case as well, John Stoll, who spent 20 years in prison. Six children said that he molested them. There were more than 60 counts of child molestation. And when I first looked at it, I thought, how can this guy be innocent with all these kids? And when we went and talked to each one of them, and they were all close to 30 at that point, they all said, yeah, I made it up completely, but I figured he must have molested the other kids, so what difference does it make? We ended up walking him out. There's a movie about that that Sean Penn did, and several books. Then we just get the simple thing, somebody tells a lie. Forget about science and all these complex reasons why people are wrongfully convicted. A lot of people are just wrongfully convicted of lies, and humans lie a lot. And there's often good reasons for it. One of the reasons is that California has some of the heaviest sentences in the United States and has three strikes. And when you see these guys that are facing that third strike, they will snitch their mom out to get around that third strike. Yep. And so you get, sometimes they've got real information, sometimes they've got false information. And just to the north of us here, the county just on our border leads the nation in snitch scandals, Orange County. And if you go down a rabbit hole of that tonight on the internet, you will not believe the stories coming out of Orange County. So I retract my earlier statement that it gets weirder the further you get from the ocean. Further you get from the ocean, and then when you go north a little bit, it gets weirder in both directions. Jason Perkow was one of my clients who got released, and his was just purely, police corruption. The police tried to shake him down for a bribe. He wouldn't pay it. They arrest him and just, fabricate a case against him. Some of you should be aware of, looking at the ages of people around this room, of the Rampart scandal in Los Angeles 20 years ago. I mean, surreal is the only word to put to that. That a division of the Los Angeles Police Department that was devoted to policing gangs became a gang themselves with their own gang tattoo and running crimes on the streets. And the only reason that was disclosed was because one of them got caught stealing 7 pounds of cocaine from the evidence room, and then he started turning on his buddies, and before you know it, we find out there's all these police officers operating as a gang. And Brian Banks is probably my most famous case, because there's a movie made about it, with Greg Kinnear playing me. And let me tell you this story a little bit, because it's very basic too. What happens when a 15-year-old tells a lie and nobody investigates it?
We're starting here with a story that reads like a movie. It's about a young guy with a promising NFL career derailed by a prison sentence for a crime he did not commit.
Yeah, it took him years to just clear his name, and now he's getting a second chance to pursue his dream. Sports anchor Rob Powers from our New York City affiliate WABC is here with more.
Really a fascinating story. It's hard not to root for him. The National Football League preseason, it can drag on, but at least one player is enjoying every minute of it. The NFL has quarterbacks, halfbacks, and fullbacks. And this preseason, one very important comeback. 28-year-old Atlanta Falcon linebacker, rookie Brian Banks, is one step closer to making his dream a reality after taking to the gridiron against the Cincinnati Bengals this week.
Nice job getting off a block and making a play.
It's still one of those situations where, it happened. Right now, it's just replaying away.
But this is no ordinary rookie. Banks joined the Falcons after spending 5 years in jail and 5 on parole. Why? He was wrongly convicted of raping a high school classmate. In May 2012, justice was served. The verdict for Banks overturned the new ruling, not guilty.
The people's motion to dismiss this case pursuant to Section 1985.
I may not ever get the answers as to why I was supposed to go through what I went through, but I know that I'm here today and I remain unbroken.
And you know, you look at the NFL right now with all the stories that are out there, the arrests, the Aaron Hernandez saga that's played out in front of us in the media, based on the hope that he has shown all of us, I wouldn't bet against Brian Banks.
Before the charges, Banks was a high school football star headed to the University of Southern California on a full scholarship to play for one of college football's best teams. But now what's in the past is in the past.
I would take this opportunity and be the best person that I could be in this world. And show people that no matter what you go through, there is light at the tunnel.
The truth is that Brian committed no crime that day, that he's a strong young man with an amazing future, and we want to get him back on track.
And back on track he is. Banks signed with the Falcons in April and picked up two tackles in Thursday's game.
Definitely one of the best moments of my life.
Really is something. So it is on to the future. The Falcons open regular season September 8th, and Brian Banks may be a long shot to make the final roster, but you know, that's okay. He has beaten the odds before, and no one is betting against him this time.
Such an incredible story. His mom stood by his side throughout
every step of the way, and now it's paying off.
A great story. Great to have you.
Nice to see you this morning.
Thanks for coming in.
It's my pleasure.
So Brian's was, again, just a very simple story that a 15-year-old told a lie. Nobody investigated it. Brian's sitting on a day of trial. I'll get an assist from the technical people, please. Nobody looks into his case. No one does any investigation. He sits in jail for a year waiting for trial. Day of trial, his lawyer tells him, look, I think I can give you probation with the judge if you plead out. If you don't plead out, we're about to go to trial. This is an all-white jury. You're probably going to be convicted. You're looking at 40 years to life. He starts crying and says, can I talk to my parents? They're right outside. He's 17 years old. The rest of him, he's 16. 17, he's making this decision. Can I talk to my parents? Nope. This is your decision. You need to make it right now. I mean, I try to imagine myself in that position as a lawyer of 30 years, when my lawyer is telling me, we're about to lose this trial, and door number one, you might go home today. Door number two, you might die in prison. What do you want to do? And so, of course, he takes the door of, the chance of going home, pleads out, and he ends up going to prison, getting the maximum sentence. And then years later, the woman comes forward, Facebook friend requests him, sends a message, can we let bygones be bygones? I'm sorry about that stuff I made up in my school. And it's just that simple. And when I questioned her, her story fell apart immediately. It's just no one had ever questioned her. And this case gets dismissed. So it's that simple. Danny Larson was one of the Rampart guys who got caught up, 16 years in prison. Horace Roberts, 20 years in prison. There's actually a murder trial going on right now in Riverside of the actual people that we found who committed the murder. And we got our guy out, and now they're going to go in. And Mike Camline, I want to end with his story here. He spent 36 years in prison, 34 of them. He was married to this woman who waited those 36 years to come home. They were married 2 years before he went to prison. And it's just a totally fabricated case where I get a letter from Mike. This is when I first started the project, and he said, I didn't do this, the lawyer did it. I thought, okay, that's kind of crazy. And then I first thought, okay, crazy stuff that guys write from prison. And it ends up, I happen to know a lawyer who's a very well-known, respected appellate lawyer in this town who worked at that law firm when he was in law school. So I call him up and I say, I get this crazy letter that your old boss maybe committed this murder? And he says, oh yeah, I can see that. And I said, what? I said, hey, we've been selling coke out of the office. He was running gang members. It was crazy. Our office got shot up one day. He's like, that's why I quit. And it ended up that that's exactly what had happened. A lawyer either killed this guy or put a hit on this guy and then covered the whole thing up with the complicit with the police department, prosecutor's office. And not only did they free Mike, they handed him a $10 million check because they didn't want to see that go to trial, that civil case, and all that be disclosed. So there's a lot of lies out there. And you know, the last chapter of my book, I get into a kind of catch-all Of all the statistics that show that when you're poor or a person of color, you are not going to get the same shake in our justice system, and that is just reality. It is deep denial to think that we can have racism in our society and it not exist in our criminal justice system, which is just a small microcosm of our society, right? 12 people pulled out of our society to make decisions. Judges pulled out of our society that are being voted on to make decisions. Of course, there's all that stuff that goes on in our system, and the statistics prove it out. And I want to leave you with a video of Mike on the day he gets out. I'll also leave you, if you want to see my daily rants on Twitter and Instagram, etc. If you haven't had enough of this now. This is the day we got Mike out of prison. Now, every one of our clients, we say to them, anywhere you want to eat, I'll take you. Because there's nothing better than going for that first meal with someone after prison. It's the best. Anywhere you want to go. And across the board, they almost always say surf and turf. Which isn't, I'm vegan, so watching it isn't a lot of fun, but we always take them there. Mike says, I haven't seen these Carl's Jr. ads for years. That looks awesome. So I was like, Mike, we can definitely take you to Carl's Jr. Here's Mike's trip to Carl's Jr.
Today is the day we are finally getting the first of the California 12 out of prison.
Death penalty because people now realize that innocent people get sentenced to death. as we approach the 200th innocent person to be freed from death row. And so we're getting that story out, and that's why I'm very aligned with all of you, because we do the same thing. We're trying to find the truth. We're trying to get to the bottom of the story. We're trying to figure out what really happened. So I'm very grateful to speak with you today. I'm very grateful for all your work. Thank you very much.
So we've got time for a few questions for Justin. So let's start right here.
Thanks, Jim. Who happened to your first case? The woman?
Thank you. Where's that nice pitch right again? Okay, so what happened to Marilyn Molinar? Thank you for asking that. I started that case when I was 29. I finished it last month. I finally got her out. It took that long to get her out. I took it up through every federal court. I took it to the United States Supreme Court. I filed a petition in the United Nations asking them to declare Chicago's criminal justice system contrary to human rights. And on my fourth petition to the Illinois governor, he finally granted it. And so I got her released 2 years ago. And then just last month, I finally got the district attorney to agree that she was factually innocent and all claims have now been dismissed against her. But I started that case when I was 29, and I finished it at 57.
Wow. So what's she doing now?
She's living in Chicago. She's working, doing construction, believe it or not. And I'm hoping to get her some compensation from the state so she can stop working construction.
The fact that they pick up innocent people, are they usually people that have a record? Are they, when they're released from jail, do they get any kind of a monetary compensation? And how do you get your salary?
Okay. We've gone from the broad to the personal. I'm free to answer your question. So, the first question there was, do people usually have a record who get wrongfully convicted? I would hate to say usually it's not uncommon, because that often leads the police to suspect that person. And then when they get introduced to trial, it leads the jury to believe maybe they did this too. And we see a lot of people, if they're affiliated with gangs, that the prosecution is 90% there, which is showing gang affiliation. So yes, often people having priors or people having affiliations can lead to wrongful convictions. But we also see middle-class people like Kim Long, who's a white middle-class nurse who just came home one day and found her boyfriend beaten to death, or Bill Richards, who's a white middle-class engineer, the same thing happened to him. So it does impact, and that's the message of my book. It can impact everyone. As to your question about compensation, when I started the California Innocence Project, under California law, you could only receive $10,000 for being wrongfully incarcerated, no matter how long you were in. And it was a very lengthy process that required hiring a lawyer to do it, so nobody ever got compensated. My office has now, we just wrote the fifth version of the compensation law. Our latest version was to get the Attorney General out of the process, because particularly the former Attorney General, now Vice President, probably nameless, was blocking a lot of them. And now they get $150 a day for every day they're wrongfully incarcerated. So just this month, we handed $1 million checks to two of our clients who spent 20 years in prison. How do I get paid? Well, I'm happy to say I've never taken any salary from the Innocence Project. This was literally my additional project as a law school professor that takes up 60 hours a week of my time for 20 years. So I get paid as a law professor to teach, and I run the clinic out of my law school with my law students, and so I've never taken a salary from it. If you're interested in donating, you go to CaliforniaInnocenceProject.org, and those donations will not go to my salary, but go to our work.
Okay, let's just do two more.
It's pretty
simple. Do you have a big voice?
How many attorneys are affiliated with this program nationwide?
So that's something I've been thinking a lot about lately. So our first meeting of the Innocence Network was five of us in 1998 sharing a pizza in a living room in Chicago. Okay? Me, Mary Shepard, a few other lawyers. We now have, as I said, we've got 60-some projects in the United States. We have 32 projects in Latin America. We have a network in Europe. We have a network in Asia. And so at the last meeting we had in Arizona, in April, there were 1,200 people present at it. So it's lawyers, students, board members. It's become a movement, because there's innocent people in prison everywhere, and this work is needed everywhere.
Okay, there is one over here. Can you just... Not
here. I came here today to tell people that 90% of California Court of Appeal decisions are ordered not to be published and cannot be cited in courts. I'm concerned. I'd like to know what your experience has been with that, and in particular, the criminal court docket. The criminal court docket in Los Angeles. The figure is not 90% are ordered not published, but 98% of the cases that are decided by the Court of Appeals in criminal cannot be used to seek exoneration of your clients. I'd like to know what your experience has been with that and what your view of it is.
Sure. So obviously, practicing these cases here for the past 23 years, most of my decisions have not been published from exactly what you said. I sometimes have mixed feelings about it. On one hand, I think we should have everything published, everything released. There's First Amendment issues that obviously are near and dear to all your hearts. So I'm in general in favor of everything being published, everything being disclosed. With one interesting caveat in my world, and this is where I sometimes struggle between being a civil libertarian and being an innocence lawyer. In fact, this week I was teaching about DNA in my criminal procedure class, and all my students were saying, the police shouldn't be able to gather your DNA, they shouldn't have data banks. And I got up and I said, I'm going to be honest with you all, I've been a civil libertarian my whole life, but I've also walked multiple people out of prison because those data banks exist. And so it's a really hard issue for me, because I know my clients would have died in prison without those databases, even though I understand part of being a U.S. citizen should be part of having some sense of privacy. And the same thing, I've seen some judges hide behind the lack of publishing to get decisions out that helped us. And one I talked about today, Judge Ito, when he ruled that failure to call an expert on identification was ineffective assistance of counsel and released my client, he didn't publish the decision, because he knew that that's just not what happens in California. They don't call ID experts. So he kind of had a way out without creating binding precedent, but being able to get my client out. So it's again, I mean, life is still with this, right? I mean, you know, when you send your kids to school, I really believe in public schools, and I really think my kids should get educated along with everybody else, but I'd really love to get them to that GATE program or that seminar, because I want my kid to do really well, even though it's elitist and not good. I mean, our values are challenged by our daily lives experience. And
that's please check website www.nonpublication.com for a full workflow.
Okay, Justin, thank you so much for your time.